Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Paul's Church of the Nazarene. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Let us pray. Good Shepherd, we gather here in your presence to worship, to adore, to remember who you are and who you have called us to be. We give you thanks that you are with us, that you are with us in the darkest valleys, and that you are with us beside still waters and green pastures. Lord, may we be especially aware of your presence with us today as we worship you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. And so now we light the Christ candle as a reminder of the Good Shepherd's presence with us this morning. God is and now, church, receive this blessing. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us stand and sing.
We're going to give a happy shout out this morning to the Lord for all he has given us. Happy day.
The greatest day in history, that the Spirit in you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won that day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And alive.
continue with praising his name with Alleluia to the Lamb and Alleluia.
Lord,
morning comes from John chapter 10, verses 22 through 30. John chapter 10, verses 22 through 30. And you may be seated. And the word of the Lord reads, "Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were gathered around him saying, 'How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly.' Jesus answered, 'I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one.'" And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Lift up to you especially Linda and Danny and their family as they mourn the loss of this speech. Lord, death is always hard. Death is never easy to face. But on this day, we ask that you would be near to those who are mourning. To Linda, to Danny, and their family. Yes, they would be near also to Mel and her family. And all of the many others who are mourning today, I think. For recent losses, for Lord, upon your losses of this day. Lord, we know that you are a God who is near to the brokenhearted. And we know that you are a God who loves and cares for our needs. And so we lift up to you the many other burdens on our hearts today. Think of Barbara who fell, broke some ribs, and we ask that you would bring her healing and comfort to this difficult. We think of Gigi as she's recovering from her surgery and ask that you would be near to her, that she would find quiet pastures to rest in while she recovers, and that she would know your comfort and your strength. Lord, for these and the many, many other things that we have, we give you thanks for being our good shepherd who loves and cares for us. Lord, help us to be faithful sheep, to faithfully follow you where you lead us, to faithfully serve you and not our own interests. Lord, help us to be your faithful people. Help us to recognize your voice in the midst of the chaos and the noise. And so, Lord, we pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you for your faithfulness in giving, and thank you that you are standing by the church with your faithfulness in time and giving, and we so appreciate that. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, and we thank you over and over again, because you are a God who gives and gives and gives. Help us to be good stewards of not only our money, but our time and our speech and every aspect of our lives, Lord. May it all be dedicated to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
others in our life today. So if you are going to help me do that this morning, I invite you to come forward at this time. We have some great helpers who have volunteered to help out this morning.
To all the women who have raised us,
to all the women who have discipled us,
to all the women who encourage us, pray for us, and support us,
to all the women who give generously of themselves,
to all the women who model the love of Christ, we say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, we do want to say thank you to all of our mothers and to all of the women today. We appreciate all you do, all of the ways that you give of yourselves so faithfully and generously, and so we want to honor you this morning. We also want to honor you through a special time of prayer and blessing. And throughout this prayer, I'm going to invite you to participate. When you hear me say the words, Lord, in your mercy, I'm going to invite you to join me by together saying, hear our prayer. Can we practice that real quick? So, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Perfect. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, you are the giver of life. In your creativity, you made a way for us to reproduce, to bring new life into the world. For all of our mothers who bore us in their wombs, carried us in their bodies, and brought us into the world, we are grateful and give you thanks. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
On this day set aside to remember our mothers, we recognize that there are many for whom this day brings a multitude of feelings and a variety of memories. For those whose mothers have died, who are no longer able to give them a call or reach for a hug, we ask, God, that you would comfort those who are missing their mothers today. For those mothers who have lost a child, we pray for your comfort and deep, unending love. Lord, in your mercy. For those whose mothers are far away, separated by physical distance, by illness that results in emotional distance, or those among us who are estranged from their mothers, we ask for your healing spirit, for the hope of your resurrection, which makes all things new. Lord, in your mercy. There are also women we know and treasure who hope to be mothers, but have not been able to for a lack of partnership, life's timing, or as a result of infertility. For these women, God, may your spirit of love and worthiness wash over them. May they find in your church the expanse of your great family, and the welcome of mothers of all kinds. Lord, in your mercy. For the women among us who are single, or who do not have a desire to be a mother themselves, but who give of themselves to others through the gift of their time, their love, and their resources, we give thanks. May they know that they are enough, just as they are, and that they are created in your holy image. For those women who have served as spiritual mothers among us, discipling us, praying for us, showing the love of Jesus to us, we give you praise and ask for your continued blessing upon their lives. Lord, in your mercy. God, for those women who are mothers themselves, blessed with the gift and challenge of nurturing, loving, and caring for their children, we ask for your spirit of encouragement and endurance. May they seek you for strength and your church for support. For those expectant mothers, we pray for safety and peace as they prepare for this transition. May they know that you and we are with them. Lord, in your mercy. Our triune God, who is both Father and Mother of all, pour out your spirit on your children as we continue to seek you day by day. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. with us today. We want to honor you. We want to thank you for all that you do in love to serve both Christ and his church. We want to celebrate who you are in Christ today. And so following the service, our children will be at the back door here and this door here to hand out just a very small gift to you. But we want to let you know that we see you today, we honor you, and we love each and every one of you. So thank you, thank you, thank you for all that you do. I do want to make you aware of just a few announcements before we dive into our sermon text this morning. And the first announcement is that all of those who ordered chocolates, they are ready today. You will be able to pick them up after the service. And so once again, we want to say thank you for supporting our teens and their efforts to go to camp. We greatly appreciate it. We also want to say a special thank you to Pastor Daniel. I don't even want to know how many hours he put into getting these chocolates ready this week, but he shopped for all the ingredients. It was at least 3 evenings of making chocolates this week. And so we greatly appreciate you. Danae helped so much. Kelly helped organize and put everything together. Pastor Colleen did as well. She's unable to be with us this morning. But we want to say thank you to all of those who helped serve and make this a possibility as well. Daniel, did you have something you wanted to say about the chocolates? Okay. Yes, so we will have a table right out there. If you will make sure to go by that table, we will make sure you pick up your chocolates. And thank you again for supporting our teams. We also want to let you know that a memorial service will be held for Linda Gray's mother and Danny's grandmother this Wednesday, May 11th, at the Newcomers Floral Fields Funeral Home, which is at 7000 Blue Ridge Boulevard, just shortly up the way here. A time of visitation will take place from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., and then the memorial service will begin at 10 a.m. with a graveside service to follow. All members of St. Paul's are welcome to attend in support of Linda and Danny and their family, and so we appreciate your continued prayers for them and their family during these days of grief. Kelly Hoagland will be up at church once again this Friday morning from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. to sort clothes for our upcoming Make a Difference Day weekend. So any help I know would be deeply appreciated if you're able to come and help sort clothes. I know that it would be very much appreciated. Our annual church elections are going to take place next Sunday, May 15th, before and after the morning worship service. So if you are a member of St. Paul's Church of the Nazarene and you are at least 15 years of age or older, we encourage you to participate in this year's election. And we ask that as you go throughout this week that you might be praying for discernment and praying for those who will be elected, that they might have the wisdom and strength needed to serve in this upcoming year. Next Sunday, we have the exciting opportunity following our morning worship service to celebrate our 2022 St. Paul's graduates. And we have a great group of graduates this year. You'll notice all of their names. We've got Juliana Alleman, who's a 2022 college graduate, Serena Fredman, Cicely Fredman, MJ Falau, and Amber Hoagland, who are all 2022 high school graduates, and Kelly Prince, who graduated last weekend from MTS. But we are so excited to celebrate the accomplishments of these graduates. Each of our high school graduates will have a table in the gym set up. Parents, if you want to bring pictures or little mementos or however you want to decorate that, you are more than welcome to. But we'll have a short little reception in honor of our graduates. And so we would encourage you to make plans to stay directly following the service for that special time. And then finally, we have a church work day coming up on Saturday, May 21st from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. We are only about 3 months out from our 75th celebration. And we've got a lot of stuff around here that we would love to get done to help prepare our building and facilities for guests to come in for that special celebration. And so if you are able to help, this will be the first of 3 or 4 work days that we have. But again, that will take place Saturday, May 21st from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And we'll have a variety of tasks that can be done that day. So we would love to see you that on Saturday, May 21st, for that. Well, thank you to all of you for the many ways that you support and participate in the life of St. Paul's. We are grateful for each and every one of you and your faithful service. This morning, we are going to be continuing our Easter sermon series in the book of Revelation. As we continue to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and imagine what it means to be a people who live in light of Christ's resurrection here and now. And the church has decided that Easter is too great to celebrate just in one week. And so the church has devoted 7 Sundays to the joy and feasting of Easter and to this celebration of what God has done for us in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we are going to continue in this spirit and celebration of joy this morning. I'm going to invite you to turn to Revelation chapter 7. We're going to begin reading in verse 1 today. But before we begin reading, I want to give just a little bit of background. So I'd invite you to turn to Revelation chapter 7 and then put a bookmark in it for just a moment this morning. Revelation chapter 7, we'll be reading verses 1 through 4, and then 9 through 17. Let us pray as we begin this time. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen and amen. The other day, I was watching the evening news. And I saw reports of a tornado that had ripped through a small rural Midwestern town. And as picture after picture was shown of the devastation, with roofs torn off of buildings and cars that seemed to be thrown around like rag dolls and heap of debris that lay in piles, the question was asked by a reporter on the scene when looking at a particularly impacted part of town. And he asked, who could have survived? Who could have withstood such destruction? This question seems to be a regular one posed in our world as we see the many signs of brokenness all around us. We look at the destruction left behind from the most recent hurricane or wildfire, and we wonder, who can withstand such power? We see the devastation created by war and violence in places like Mariupol, Ukraine, or Aleppo, Syria, and we wonder, who can withstand such devastation? We see the latest economic downturn that places even more pressure on families that are just struggling to make ends meet, and we wonder, who can withstand this? With all of the potential hazards of our world that keep us up at night, war and violence, cancer and disease, car accidents and natural disasters, we can't help but wonder, who can possibly withstand it? This is the very same question that is posed at the end of the 6th chapter of Revelation, when referring to the opening of the first 6 seals. Who can withstand it? If you remember last week, we were in Revelation chapters 4 and 5. And in those chapters, John describes to us a beautiful vision of worship in the throne room of heaven. All of creation is gathered there together, worshiping before the throne. And if you remember in chapter 5, John's eyes become captivated by a scroll held in the hand of him who sits on the throne. And a question is posed by an angel to all of the creation gathered in that throne room. Who is worthy to open the scroll? And at first it seemed like no one was worthy, no one in all of creation. But just when John had given in to despair and had begun to weep, he is comforted and shown a vision of a lamb who is slain, one who is worthy to open the scroll of life, one who is worthy to fulfill God's good plans for the creation. In chapter 6 of Revelation, which comes right before our text for this morning, we see the lamb opened the first six of seven seals that held the scroll shut in chapter 5. And as the Lamb begins to open these seals, judgment is released upon the earth. We see here in Revelation chapter 6 that though God is merciful and gracious with good and redemptive plans for God's creation, God is also a holy and just God. Here, judgment comes upon the earth not out of God's vengeance, but out of God's justice. You see, there are consequences for the creation choosing a path other than God's path. There are consequences for humanity's sin and brokenness that cannot just be avoided. They cannot just be swept under the rug. They cannot be ignored. For the Lamb to bring forth God's redemptive future is also for the Lamb to bring about God's justice and judgment. Things must be set right again. So in chapter 6, we are told that the first of the four seals are opened, and they represent what we sometimes refer to as the four horsemen of the apocalypse. You probably have heard that type of terminology before, although it gets intermixed with a lot of other literature that isn't quite scriptural. But we have these four horsemen with horses of different colors: white, bright red, black, pale green, representing war, murder, famine, and death. Realities that for early Christian would have been viewed not just as something to come one day in the future, but realities that were all too prevalent and familiar to them living under the ruthless and oppressive rule under the Roman Empire. Following the opening of the first four seals, we are then told that the fifth seal is open. And through it, John sees under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for maintaining their testimony in Christ. Under the altar, in much of Christian tradition, is a place of great honor, reserved for those who have demonstrated their faithfulness to Christ, even unto death. There, under the altar, we are told that these souls cry out, "How long, O Lord? How long until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? How long will we have to wait?" And they are told to wait just a little while longer. The time has not yet come. Then comes the sixth seal, and with it comes a great earthquake that causes the sun to turn to black, the moon to red, the stars fall from the sky, the heavens are rolled up like a scroll, and the mountains and islands are moved from their place. And we're told as a result of this chaos that all people, kings and peasants alike, run to hide from the fearful sight. It is at this point, following the opening of this sixth seal, where the question is asked, who can withstand this? Who can withstand the judgment of the Lord? Who can withstand the consequences of humanity's brokenness and sin? Who can possibly withstand this? The answer would seem to be no one. These types of scenes, ones of earthquake and war, famine and death, stars falling from the sky, and the mountains being moved from their places, are those that cause our pulses to race, our hearts to be dismayed, our stomachs to turn in fear. It is images such as these that often cause us to enter into a reading of the book of Revelation with a certain level of fear and trembling. And by the time we get to the end of chapter 6, we get the idea that after only six of the seven seals being opened, that the creation cannot take anymore. Surely the opening of the seventh seal will push the creation over the edge. Surely it will be the final nail in the coffin of a wayward people. Who can withstand the judgment of the Lord? No one can, of course. But then at just the moment when the chaos threatens to overwhelm, there is a brief interlude, a vision of hope that is injected into the chaos and despair. Another vision given to John, a beautiful vision of worship. And that's where we 7, verse 1. So I invite you to hear this beautiful vision of worship. After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth to prevent any wind from blowing on the land or on the sea or in any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the east, having the seal of the living God. He called out in a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and the sea. Do not harm the land or the sea or the trees until we put a seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. Then I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 from the tribes of Israel. And we'll go to verse 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." And this is the word of the Lord. Who can withstand this? Who can withstand the Lord's judgment? Well, at the end of chapter 6, it would seem like surely no one can withstand it with the earthquakes, the war, the death, the famine. Here at the beginning of chapter 7, John is given a vision of a group of people who are gathered before the throne, not because they are able to withstand God's judgment in their own power and strength, but because God, who is the shepherd, has made a way for them. We are told in verse 1 that John sees four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, probably a sign that at this point they still believe the earth to be flat. And they see the angels at the four corners of the earth holding back the blowing winds from this group so that they are not overwhelmed. Just when it seems like the chaos will win, God provides. God steps in. God prevails. Amen. This group is described as a group of 144,000 from all of the tribes of Israel, with 12,000 in number coming from each of the tribes. Now, this is most likely not intended to suggest to us that only 144,000 people from Israel will be saved, as it is sometimes literally interpreted. But rather, it is intended to show us that people from all tribes, from all parts of Israel, will be included in God's plan of salvation. In other words, God's plan of salvation that began all the way back in Genesis with Abraham covenant with God will now be completed. God will be a God who keeps God's promises to God's people. But the vision does not stop there. Instead, once again, just like we saw last week, we see a difference here between what John hears and what John sees. If you remember last week, John heard the roaring lion of Judah, but he saw the Lamb who was slain. This week, John hears the 144,000 from the tribes of Israel, but he sees a multitude that no one can count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. Once again, God's plan of salvation creation is revealed as being so much bigger and more inclusive than we might be tempted to imagine. People of every nation and tribe, language and tongue, people of every color and ethnicity, speaking every language from every walk of life, with different experiences, all gathered together in worship. What a beautiful image of what worship should be. What a beautiful image of what God's kingdom is going to be like, not only one day, someday, in the great by and by, but here on earth as it is in heaven. Church, this is what corporate worship should look like as we prepare to join that great heavenly chorus in the throne room of God. John tells us that this multitude of people that cannot be counted is wearing white robes, and they are holding palm branches in their hands, and together are crying out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne, and to the Lamb." Who can withstand it? Who can withstand the judgment of the Lord? The answer would seem to be no one. But here in chapter 7, John sees a multitude of people so great in number that they cannot even be counted, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. Those who have come through the great tribulation and are now standing in the very presence of God. Who can withstand this? Apparently, a lot of people who God brings through and makes a way. We quickly realize that this group gathered there is not there in their own strength and power. They have not endured the judgment of God on the basis of their own righteousness. They have not somehow made themselves worthy or just gotten lucky. Instead, we are told that they are those who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Their salvation belongs not to their good deeds or to what they have been able to achieve, but their salvation belongs to the Lamb who was slain. Who can withstand it? Who can withstand the judgments of the Lord? Those who have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. Thanks be to God. You see, church, there is no promise here that God's people will not endure suffering. There is no promise here that God's people will somehow avoid judgment. There is no promise that God's people will somehow escape the birthing pains of the creation as it waits for the new life that God will one day complete. Salvation in Christ is not some type of escapist theology in which the people of God escape or are delivered from the brokenness of the world. It's not the type of escapist theology where God zaps up God's people and then lays the world to ruins. Instead, we see quite the opposite here. This group standing before the throne is made up of those who have come through the great tribulation. They are those who have endured, who have suffered, many of whom have given their very lives and witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Likewise, the group of churches that John is writing to and encouraging with these words of revelation are not those who are being delivered from the time of trial, but rather are those who are presently going through difficulty and persecution for their faith in Christ. They are not being brought out of it, but being brought through it.
Amen.
This brings to mind the words from Psalm 23 that Pastor Daniel read earlier. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Church, there's no promise here that we will not go through hardships. There is no promise here that faith in God will protect us from all trials and troubles and tribulations. But there is the great promise here that God will be with us every step of the way, and that God come, but rather to prepare God's people to persevere in our witness even in the midst of difficult days, even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And church, the good news is that for those who walk faithfully, for those who follow in the path of our good shepherd, for those who wash their robes white in the blood of the Lamb, there is the promise of life and life eternal. I love those beautiful words in verses 15 through 17 that describe the daily activity of those who have been washed white in the blood of the Lamb. God's word says that they are before the throne of God and serve him in his temple day and night. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. In an amazing change of imagery, the Lamb who was slain, the one who is worthy to open the scrolls, now serves as the good shepherd who leads God's people into the way of resurrection life. Church, the good news of this Easter season is not that God is making all new things, but that God is making all things new. God is not simply throwing God's hands up in defeat at the broken state of the world and starting over by creating a new creation, but rather Easter is all about God being committed to taking that which is broken and sinful and given over to death and restoring and redeeming and recreating and making it new once again. The beauty of resurrection is not simply that it is something that God does in one moment in history in the life of Jesus, but the beauty of resurrection is that it is a work of redemption and restoration that God is doing in the life of all creation. Jesus is the first fruits of resurrection, the first fruits of this new creation, but God is even now beginning to restore all the rest of creation, and one day, church, one glorious day, we will be full participants in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. One day, we too will rise with Christ. One day, we too will be gathered in the very presence of God. One day, we will suffer and grieve no more. One day, there will be no more tears and no more pain, just the joy of life and life eternal in the presence of the one who sits on the throne and in the presence of the Lamb who was slain.
Amen.
Who can withstand this? Church, the answer is, apart from God, no one can possibly withstand it. No one gets out of this alive. No one can survive the consequences of our brokenness and sin. No one can make themselves right before God. No one can endure judgment in our own power and strength. But thanks be to God, we do not have to do it on our own. The vision that John sees is a multitude, not because this great numerous group was able to pull themselves up by their bootstraps, but because they had fully surrendered themselves to this way of Jesus. By the grace of God, through Christ Jesus, their clothes were washed white in the blood of the Lamb. By the grace of God, the Good Shepherd leads them faithfully into the way of life and life eternal. Church, because of what God has done for us, through the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ, we too can become participants in Easter resurrection. We, too, can become members of the new creation that God is even now restoring and redeeming and making new. We, too, can be washed white in the blood of the Lamb and led by the Good Shepherd into the way of life and life eternal. As we prepare our hearts to receive communion this morning, we're going to sing the song, I Will Rise. It's a song that talks all about our participation in in the resurrection of Christ, that one day we too will rise with Christ. One day we too will experience the glory of God's presence in its fullness. One day we too, with the great heavenly choir of saints, will proclaim forevermore, "Worthy is the Lamb." And invite us to stand and sing together. If you'd like to come to the altar during this time, I invite you to do so. Let us sing to the Lord.
Thank you.
gracious God, we are so thankful for that truth. We are so thankful for what you have done for us through Christ Jesus, our Lord, that through his life, death, resurrection, and ascension, we can be full participants in the resurrection of Christ, and that we can trust with all confidence that there is a day coming, a glorious day coming, where there will be no more pain, no more suffering, no more tears falling from our eyes, but rather we will be experiencing the joy of being in your presence, singing with that heavenly choir of saints and angels, "Worthy is the Lamb." Thank you for what you have done for us. We give you all glory and praise and honor this morning. Amen. Amen. It is at this table where we are reminded, when the question comes to our mind, who can withstand it? We are reminded that we can withstand whatever comes our way, not because we are powerful and strong in and of ourselves, but because we follow a good shepherd who has already made a way. And that by the grace of God given to us through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ at this table, we too can be washed white in the blood of the Lamb. By the gift of grace given to us by God through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ at this table, we are given the grace that continues to sustain us whatever we might face in this life. Because we are reminded that Jesus has overcome. The victory has already been won. The foe of death has already been defeated. The ending has already been written. We are just with those saints asking the Lord, how long? And we're told just a little while longer. But we're not told that we have to walk the rest of our way on our own. But rather, we are being brought through the trials and troubles and tribulations of this life by the good shepherd who has already walked the way of death and come out the other side. And that is the way for each one of us who is found in Jesus Christ. Christ our Lord invites all to this table who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live at peace with one another. Therefore, I'm going to invite us this morning to confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray the prayer of confession together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Hear this good news, church. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, proving God's love for us. Thanks be to God, we are a forgiven people. We remember at this table that on the night our Lord was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had blessed it and given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." In the same way, after the meal, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, telling them, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do it in as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we together feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Church, in just a moment, when you are ready, I invite you to come forward and to receive the good gifts that God has for us. What happens at this table is more than just us remembering. We are actually being sustained by grace, sustained by the very body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, that we might have the strength to continue another day, that we might have the strength to endure whatever tomorrow brings, being reminded that the ending has already been written. The body and blood has already been given, and it is ours both now and forever. So as you are ready, I'm going to invite you to come. We'll come down the center aisle and then return to our seats where we'll receive together. As we usually do, I'm going to invite you to come with open hands, not grasping and grabbing for what we think we somehow deserve, but coming with open hands to receive the free and gracious gifts that God gives to each one of us. So church, as you are ready, I invite you to come, taste, and see that the Lord sacrifice.
together as God's people, we say, thanks be to God. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Church, receive this benediction. May you know the presence of the Good Shepherd as you go through your lives this week, and especially when you find yourself in the valley of the shadow of death. And may you be the hands and feet of Jesus to those who find themselves in those places as well. Let us go singing God's praises. Go in the grace and the peace of God to love and serve your neighbor. Awesome.